Hello and welcome back to Ocarina of Time Master Quest, and this is actually going to be the video that summarizes the collecting of skeletons for Hyrule as adult up to the Shadow Temple and the Bomb of the Whale as child. You can do Bomb of the Whale as adult now, I believe. I think you can get into like 4 or 5 rooms as adult now with a new glitch that was found last week. But to be honest, the glitch doesn't really seem that worthwhile for the time being. Getting into Bomb of the Whale as adult is the only thing you can do in Master Quest if you get into Bomb of the Whale as adult is get the Once the Truth and Leave, but because I'm kind of doing 100%, I need to go in as a child and get all the skeletons anyway. So I'm going to go in as a child and pick up everything that I can get. The reason that I'm speeding up this process is because, as you already know from playing the game probably yourself, traveling around Hyrule and collecting stuff that you need to, if you're doing 100% playthrough, takes a very long time, and this in itself, this footage that you're watching here, would be about 10 minutes if I hadn't sped it up. The reason that most people even speed up videos is generally because the process of what you're seeing isn't really important, nor is it really needed to actually be at its normal pace. The skeleton that I just got here, you can actually get it with a normal hookshot if you stand on the edge of a red roof. That's like foreground, like on the ground level. You can actually do 2 sword swipes and take out your hookshot and aim to the opposite roof and hookshot yourself there. And from there, you can pull yourself up to the top roof and collect the skeleton. But if you just want to do it as an adult when you're kind of supposed to, I guess Nintendo really didn't think about it. But you can wait until you get the long shot. This minigame here, if you're playing on GC or VC, it's really annoying to do correctly. This is because of the process of you shooting the arrows with the GameCube controller. It's actually really sensitive. The reasoning behind this is because of the fact that the GameCube was never really calibrated to be on the same sensitivity and dead zone level as an N64 controller. So whenever you actually go to move the control stick on the N64, you're actually getting 2 times the amount of pull that you would on a GameCube. So, well, actually it's the opposite way around. On the GameCube, you're getting 2 times the sort of pull as you would on the N64. So whenever you go left or right when you're in FPS mode and in Ocarina of Time or any Zelda game, or even in Mario, if you're looking around in first person, you're gonna get movements that are 2 times the amount of width that you're actually kind of looking for. You're gonna have to be way more sensitive with the controller than what you should have to be to get in that position. It's kind of ridiculous, but Nintendo really didn't have much of a choice unless they wanted to reprogram the entire engine for the GameCube. They had to, obviously they've done some programming to the engine because the fact that the buttons are different, the sword button's red and the green button is the A button now, so it's obvious that he did do some work. This cutscene is by far one of the most memorable cutscenes in Ocarina of Time. A lot of people remember this cutscene particularly because of the fact that Kakariko is on fire. You can actually get to this cutscene if you have a ROM and an emulator, and you load up a thing called Beta World within the cheats options. And you can come and walk in here and whatever, and it's really weird because some of the characters that aren't in the adult timeline or in this beta village, the camera just doesn't show where they are. But it's very, very strange to see them, and if you speak to them, they have the dialogue that they do in Castletown as a child after Ganondorf chases Zelda and Impa out of the castle. It's kind of strange that, they kind of left their models there and never did anything in the adult timeline with them. Many people debated whether or not the characters were killed off within the adult era, I guess, Ganon's rule to power and whatever in Market Town. And a lot of people seem to think that those re-deads are actually dead villagers and revived or whatever through Ganon's magic into their zombie form. I don't remember where I read this, but apparently those 3 deads in Market Town are just Ganon's magic. They're not real people. Or is that the logic behind redeads in general? I forget, to be honest, but I'm pretty sure someone might be able to clarify that in the comments if we're that interested in knowing what the redeads are. I just hated them as a kid. I was always creeped out by zombies, so I particularly just never really thought about whether or not they were dead or not. They're still like zombies that bite the living hell out of you and try and, well, sexually abuse Link. Now, I believe I already have the Song of Storms because I believe I already have the frog heart pieces, so I don't have to go into the windmill and collect up the Song of Storms. However, I'm not even going to be using the Song of Storms. I'm going to show a glitch that everybody probably is aware of. But a glitch that actually breaks the game to the point where you can leave the forest as a child before you even get the Kokiri sword. It's a very exploited glitch in any percent runs of the game. Just in the last week, any percent has actually changed a lot in this game, and in my bonus video, I'm gonna go into a bit of detail about some of the glitches that are used in any percent. There's actually a tutorial made by a well-known runner of the game, ironically called Runner Guy. I can't remember his numbers right now, sorry if he ever sees this, but he made a tutorial about RBA, which is kind of an any percent, I suppose, at all. It's kind of outdated now, but it goes into a lot of detail that I'm probably not going to be able to explain. So, in the bonus video, I'll be sure to link to his tutorial. Nocturne of Shadow is more of a memorable song than Serenade of Water, I feel. Serenade of Water is just a song that is really easy to play. Apart from the last, like, eight notes, like in the actual song, then it's pretty much another song that I would never really remember, like off the top of my head. The only reason I remember the last eight notes is because of that, that every time you play the Ballad of the Winds or something, whatever the teleportation song is in Wind Waker, the last eight notes are played every time that you play that or teleport to another area. Well, not teleport, but like warp to another area via the cyclones. Right now I'm doing something called Super Swim. I'm really surprised at how many people don't really know about this. Well, this isn't Super Swim, but this is like I'm trying to think, Fast Swim, I guess? I don't know the terminology name. Super Swim is something different, but I never actually showed it off because I wasn't confident with it. I will in the bonus video, obviously, but pressing B rapidly when you're in the water increases the pace that Link swims at. It's very strange. I'm not sure if it's actually present in the 3DS version. It may be, I'm not entirely positive, but it's not really a glitch. It's like, it just resets the animation. It's very weird. I'm not sure if it has something to do with the fact that, like, the game thinks you want to take out the sword, but the sword's inactive. I'm not sure. But it resets the animation, so Link just gets, like, the swimming motion consistently and speeds up the pace of that he swims at. It's a really weird transition. So it's time to go back to the past and become a child again. I had to save and reset the game, obviously, because I was done recording in that session. The previous session was from the Water Temple, so we're back at normal speed, and the rest of the video is going to be normal speed now. But the whole collect-a-thon in the beginning had to be sped up because that was a really, really long segment. I really didn't want to do anything with it other than show the sheet cutscene at the normal speed of what it normally is shown. So yeah, we're a child again, and if you take out your Ocarina and play the Nocturne of Shadow, we'll be taken to the graveyard where we can go right to the well. Many people, from what I've read and stuff, I've said this is their least favorite part of the game, mainly because of the fact, I guess, it creeped me out a lot as a kid. I'm kind of the opposite. It creeped me out as a kid, but I actually really enjoy this part of the game. This part of the game is like pushing the limits on really what was shown in a lot of video games back then. A lot of video games didn't really have the undead consistently, like in a chilled environment, like in a children's video game. Didn't really try and creep you out to the level that you would actually stop playing the game. Zelda did a really good job of that as a kid. I remember even like being that terrified of it that I get my parent to kind of do the story segment of the game. But it's something I actually enjoy playing myself now as an adult. It's just a more enjoyable sequence to actually realize the creative like thought process that Nintendo probably had to go through to make this game what it is now. So if you stand here, like, there's this thing in the game, basically, when you come into a new area or an area that you've never noticed, like, Navi and spoke to her before, 20 seconds in, you get a command prompt, and you can do this. Now, water actors don't take place on, like, in cutscenes. Navi counts as a cutscene. What happened there is I was standing on the edge of the well, and I drew my sword, that pushed me off the legend itself, and then I hit B to jump slash back on. Now when I land back on there, and slide back, when I stand back up again, I'll fall into the water, but in the last frame, you hit up C, and then Navi speaks to you and you can fall through water. You can do this in the Lost Woods when you first start the game, and do it on top of the entrance to Zora's River, and you can fall right through there. It's kind of interesting, like, that you can actually do that, and you can weave the forest without beating the Deku Tree, getting the shield, getting the sword, doing anything. You can go right out into Hyrule Field, and it's kind of cool that you can do that. It's one of the most well-known glitches within this game. And it works in 3DS, before anybody asks any comments. It does work in 3DS. It's still a valid glitch in 3DS. The 3DS one is actually becoming even more broken than this game. It's kind of surprising, because the any percent world record for 3DS is like 36 minutes or something now. It's kind of ridiculous to actually think that the 3DS is actually faster logically in any percent category than that of the N64 currently, or the GameCube or the Virtual Console. It's crazy to see that, but that's the way it is right now. See, I did a jump slash to charge my crouch tab to, you know, like, store the power within my crouch tab. So when the wall master comes down, if it ever does, they're really annoying to deal with. There they are. He'll basically be, like, a lot more easy to kill, just because of the fact I have a stronger attack still within my crouch stab. I think he takes 4 normal slashes when you're a kid. You get double damage from a jump attack, obviously, and the Deku Stick is the most powerful attack that a child Link has. In this bottom of the well, there's only a couple areas that you would actually be kind of like, oh, I don't know where the hole is, and fall through. A lot of other times, you'll just be like, whatever, it's fine, I'll just keep walking. But there are some areas within the game where you're just kind of like, I might be careful around here in case there is a hidden bit in the floor, and then you kind of fall through. In this room here, there's a Skeletor, like a golden Skeletor, and he's hiding in this room under the grave, but there's so many enemies within this area that are invisible that it's really hard to tell. Most people do this room when you have the Lance of Truth, but if you know where everything is, then you can just kind of guess and kill everything in the process of you doing all the... Like, you can use Deku Nuts to bring down the bat, so they're on the floor and you can get it. The Skeletor is going to be taken out with bombs, so you don't have to guess when they're facing away from you or looking at you. Yeah, it's pretty easy to deal with if you have the right equipment. This room here, if you just stick to the right wall, you'll walk right past all of that. The only part of this room that has a hole in it is actually like the middle of the room. The right wall and all the way along to the other side is like a solid kind of floor that's just invisible. If you had the Lens of Truth, I'd be able to show you that, but you know, I don't have it, so I can't really show you. And there's no point in me wasting my time going back up here after I get the Lens of Truth. The Lens of Truth is probably going to be the last thing that you get inside of the bottom of the well. Everything else is upstairs, other than a golden sculptor that's downstairs, but I guess you get after getting the Lens of Truth. But yeah, there isn't really a lot to the bottom of the well when it comes to this version. To be honest, I think the original was a more difficult dungeon than what this one is. And many different things happen in the original that don't happen here. The Dead Hand fight is the most frustrating fight in this game, I feel. I can't one-cycle him. I tried to get a one-cycle, but I either got caught by the hands, which just happened to me there, or just never got the right frame to attack him. You see what I mean? When I try and get the frame, it's really, really difficult to do. So yeah, I'm just trying to get a... See, I jump attack him, but I hit his face before he does the animation to go back in the ground. If he... It's about to go back in the ground and you do a jump slash, you'll actually hit him on the frame that he goes back into the ground, and the game thinks it's acceptable for him to take damage at that point. So it's a really stupid process, and I keep getting caught by the hand here when I just try and hit him. Here we go again. I miss the frame because of the fact I hit him way too early. Hit him twice way too early, thinking he would pause and go back into the ground before he did. Dead Hand, it's really hard to one cycle him. I've seen like many quote unquote professional Zelda runners like miss it a lot. Like they'll be like, one cycle Dead Hand, I am God, pretty much after they get it. And it's really difficult to get. Like they're always surprised if they get it, or they know that they're incredibly lucky if they get it. Free cycle is the worst you can get with Dead Hand, I think, if you know how to get max damage off him. One cycle is the best, obviously, and two cycles, like, yeah, you still got a hit off him when he was going back into the ground, so whatever. But yeah, Dead Hand is my least favorite mini boss in the entire game. Just because of that one process, it's like he takes forever to fight. He goes back into the ground, he's a coward, he retreats, and his hands are really obnoxious to deal with. There's this room over here, which I suppose many people would know is the room where you get a couple of skeletons in the original version of the game. If you come in here now, there'll be a Gibdo the moment you come into the door. You want to hit your Ocarina on the frame that you regain control of Link and play Sun Song, or you're going to get frozen and take quite a lot of damage. I'm not sure how many hearts these guys do, but if you just jump attack him with a stick, you'll take him out fairly easily. So yeah, I'm trying to get a glitch up here called, and I got it there, the ISG, which is Infinite Sword Glitch. The camera angle is kind of funny right now, like it's not able to keep up with Link that well, but this glitch has a lot of effects. Right now my sword is infinitely stabbing, so I can just walk up to things and it'll do damage to things and whatever. Now it's gone because I've left the room sort of thing. Like anytime you interact with another object, it disappears unless you re-establish it. I'll explain that glitch in a bonus video, but it's one of the most useful glitches in this game. Like, it's actually the most known and the most useful glitch within this game. And I'm sure I'll try and get it on Bunko Bunko, but you can get ISG off a lot of things. Bombs, signs, rocks, I think bushes too, cuckoos you can get them off of, people, enemies that you can target, switches and stuff that Navi can target, Navi herself actually, and this one particular watch it for the Shadows of the Monsters thing. If you get it in the right frame, you can get it there too, but that's like almost impossible. Nobody should ever try and do that. It's very difficult. So yeah, I throw a bomb here to take out both the Skeletors without any problem, and then just push the switch. The reason I didn't deal with the Floor Master or the Wall Master is because you don't have to. You can just kind of avoid him. Like, he'll attack me and whatever, and I'll just be like, see you later, and walk out of the room, and the Wall Master won't come down, and the Floor Master won't hit me, because I'm moving, like, out of its kind of attack range, like its field of attack, I guess. So now that we've opened up the hatch in the middle of the main room, we can go down there. And there's a switch on this platform behind me, and if I push this, it'll make a chest appear in an area with blue frame frames? Flames, and a re-dead. Really can't talk today, don't know what's up with me. And if I crouch stab and sort of power off a jump attack, I'm just gonna take out the Wallmaster, because of the fact that he's gonna be a real nuisance down here. If you take him out, he won't spawn throughout the time that you're down here, so just kill him off, so you don't get attacked by him when you're trying to do something a bit more important. There's four Raidettes over here, possibly five, and you just want to take them all out. Yeah, five of them. You just want to take them all out. Once one of them are dead, they won't kind of attack you, but you're as well taking them out. They have this thing, like this animation programming, where they'll walk up to the dead corpse and kind of sit by it. Many people would debate whether or not they're eating the other re-dead, or whether or not they're mourning the other re-dead. I don't know myself what they're doing, but it's in their programming to sit over the corpse of their friend until their friend disappears. So, well, not their friend, but their other kind. Yeah, so all the re-deads are gone, but they disappear over time. Most of the undead enemies, apart from Stalfos, disappear over time. They don't, like, disappear instantaneously. Deadhand also disappears over time, which is kind of creepy. He kind of melts, though, which is even weirder. Redez kind of disappear, same with Gyarados. Although Gyarados and Redez are essentially the same enemy, anyway. Just a different texture mod over them. In this game, you can't just attack them with a fire arrow or a dense fire, and it won't burn off their bandages, but in Majora's Mask, it'll burn off their bandages, and they'll just be a re-dead underneath. It's kind of cool that Nintendo even considered that. So yeah, back here in the Temple of Time, we're gonna try out the Master Sword and go back to being an adult after I go and get a heart piece from town. Now that we have the Lens of Truth, I can do a minigame in town without any chance of failing and get a heart piece from it. The reason that most people get it now is because of the fact it's like a 1 in 6 chance that you're gonna get it, I think. However many rooms are in this place, it's like 1 in 5 and 1 in 6. There's like 5 or 6 different rooms with 2 chests within them. Each one has a key and a rupee, separated into, you know, individual chests or whatever. And you have to go into these rooms and pick out the key to progress to the end to get a heart piece. It's a really stupid minigame that you need this particular item for, and it's the only item you can use in here, which is kind of ironic. You practically have to cheat, basically, to guarantee that you're going to be able to do it. If you guess, without the Lens of Truth, you're going to be here for a really long time. I wouldn't be surprised if you ran out of money doing this, so, yeah, just go ahead and do this. Because it's one of the, I don't know, the 36 hard pieces within the game? I think it's 36, because there's 37 technically within the game, but, it's, the 37th one is something you're not going to be able to get. You can also dupe heart pieces, so I guess that's kind of a factor too. Eh, whatever. Yeah, so you get to this room at the end and you get a heart piece from this chest here. And that's pretty much it. I don't really think there's anything more to cover in Castletown other than a Skulltula up next to the castle, which I'll get later, I guess. I don't really think I have a plan of when I'm gonna get probably before I do the child section of the Spirit Temple. So yeah, I'm probably gonna get it then before I head back to the Spirit Temple and whatever and do the child part of the Spirit Temple. Okay, so we're going back to the Temple of Time and I really can't be bothered walking there, so I end up playing the Prelude of Light to go back to the Temple Time. I'm not sure if this would have been quicker or slower going back. I have never timed it, but I'd assume it's like a couple of seconds quicker. It's not like it really matters in the end. You're still going back to the Temple Time. So yeah, we're going back to get a Master Sword and whatever, and we're gonna have to take on the Shadow Temple after this. There's a few things in the Shadow Temple I won't be showing, glitch-wise that is, so just be aware of that. I probably won't show that the skip to the boss teeth that was recently discovered, and the the jump slash to show to skip most of the temple. I probably won't be doing that. I'm probably gonna show it in the bonus video, but I won't be doing it in, you know, in this run of the Shadow Temple. I can do that at any point in time. So back to the graveyard we go. I can't play Ocarina for crap today, apparently. This was recorded like half an hour ago, so yeah. I apparently can't play Ocarina for crap. So yeah, we're teleporting back to the graveyard and entering the Shadow Temple. The Shadow Temple, you can enter it by glitching, I guess, up to a seam up there in a wall, and then kind of walking over here. And then you have an unloaded room here, where there's no torches and no door. However, if you have the Inspire, you can open this, and there's no reason to really do the seam levitation to get over here. So yeah, you can just walk in here now. I don't believe you can do it as a child, but you could try, I guess. But yeah, that's pretty much it for this video, so thanks for watching, and stay tuned for the Shadow Temple, which will be out soon. Thanks, and goodbye. Thank you.